Yes, good morning, students. So we are going to start with the, we are like going to continue with the chapter, The Landscape of the Soul. So here we talked about yesterday, like the difference between the Chinese art and European art. So we discussed yesterday in the introduction part, the Chinese art, related to Chinese art, we read about two stories. One story was about Daozi, and the other story was about a painter. At Antwerp, there was a painter, the one who wanted to marry a girl whose father was a great painter. So the person who wanted to marry that girl, he was actually a blacksmith, and he was not allowed to marry the daughter of a painter. So in order to woo the father, the boy decided to go to the studio of his father-in-law, and there he painted a fly. And it was so realistic that the painter was impressed by this, you know, painter, and he trained him. And eventually that very blacksmith turned out to be a great painter later on. So that painting where he drew a fly, and that turned out to be so realistic, that was also where, that was also something we read about yesterday. Then afterwards, the writer is making it very clear, like Chinese art is about concept. It's all about concept. It's about life. It's about spirit and inner life, inner self. And European art, it's an illusionistic likeness. So illusionistic likeness, where you have to, where the things seem to be, but they are not actually. So the fly was not there, but it seemed to be true. So then, now we are on page number 36. The concept is expressed as shan shui, literally mountain water, which used together represent the word landscape. So this very concept of Chinese art, you know, it can be expressed as shan shui, where, which literally means mountain water. And together mountain water is used to say landscape. More than two elements of an image, these represent two complementary poles reflecting Taoist view of the universe. The mountain is yang, reaching vertically towards heaven, stable, warm, and dry in the sun, while the water is yin, horizontal and resting on the earth, fluid, moist, and cool. So this concept of shan shui can be explained in as the concept of yin and yang, where yin is the earth, okay? So where the water is yin, which is moist and cool, and whereas this very yang, you know, yang is mountain, which reaches towards the heaven. So that very mountain, that is yang, is stable, warm, and dry, whereas yin is fluid, moist, and cool. So between mountain and water, what is there? There is void. So that is what we are going to do. The interaction of yin, the receptive feminine aspect of universal energy, and its counterpart yang, active and masculine, is of course a fundamental notion of Taoism. What is often overlooked is an essential and third element, the middle void, where their interaction takes place. So here, if the concept is of yin and yang, yang is mountain, yin is water, and the interaction takes place in the middle void. Okay, and it is the middle void which is more important than anything else, because interaction takes place over there. So what is often overlooked is an essential third element, that is middle void, where the interaction takes place. This can be compared with the yogic practice of pranayama. Breathe in, retain, and breathe out. And the suspension of breath is the void where meditation occurs. So the concept of yin yang or shan shui can be explained with the example of pranayama also. What do you do in the pranayama? You breathe in, you retain the breath, then you breathe out. So meditation occurs not while breathing in and breathing out, because that breathing in, breathing out we normally do. Right now also we are breathing in and breathing out, but it's not meditation. Meditation occurs when we breathe, when we retain the breath. So that is like the middle void. Okay, yin and yang are like breathing in and breathing out, and retention of the breath is like the middle void. And it's the middle void where meditation occurs, and it's the middle void in that shanshui where the interaction takes place. So the middle void is essential. Nothing can happen without it. Hence the importance of the white unpainted space in Chinese landscape. So middle void is depicted in the Chinese landscape in the form of white paint. So that white paint is the middle void, and that is very important in the Chinese paintings. So this is also where man finds a fundamental role. In that space between heaven and earth, he becomes the conduit of communication between both poles of the universe. So where is the role of man? So if we talk about the universe, heaven and earth, man comes in between. Man is the middle. Man is the middle void where the interaction takes place. So his presence is essential, even if it's only suggested. Far from being lost or oppressed by the lofty peaks, he is, in Francois Chang's wonderful expression, the eye of the landscape. So the most important element in this universe is man. Okay. So, and even the Francois Chang, you know, he even says that man is the eye of the landscape. So then, now we are going to talk about the second part of this chapter. In the first part, we talked about Chinese art and European art, where man is the most important, you know, element. Now, second part of the chapter is about the art brut. That is, now we are going to talk about art brut. And art brut means the outside art. Okay, so we are going to talk about it. So it's very important segment of this chapter, and you would like it also. So when the French painter Jean Dubuffet mooted the concept of art brut in 1940s, the art of untrained visionary was of minority interest. So this concept of art brut came in 1940s. But art brut is here the art of the untrained visionary. So the art of the untrained visionary. Who is visionary? Visionary is a person who can foresee the future. So what he had been able to envision, the kind of art he had in mind, that was that had not, you know, that didn't have any, you can say, application so far by 1940s. It was of minority interest. Nobody really took any interest in that. From its almost veiled beginnings, outsider art has gradually become the fastest growing area of interest in contemporary art internationally. So this art brut, which started off, which had a very, veiled beginning, means it did not have a very prominent, very highlighted beginning. Art brut was not very famous in the beginning. But yes, now art brut has become one of the most famous, you know, art forms in the world. The reason is it's, you know, the kind of concept it has got. So let's see what art brut is. This genre is described as the art of those who have no right to be artists, as they have received no formal training. So first of all, the art brut, it's a kind of art where the artists are not to be called artists by any means, because they don't have any formal training, yet show talent and artistic insight. So the kind of artists who go for art brut are the ones who don't have any formal training, but yes, they have artistic talent and insight. Their works are a stimulating contrast to a lot of mainstream offerings. So what they do, what they have done, that is, you know, something worth watching, worth, you know, you can say taking interest. Around the time Dubuffet was propounding his concept in India, an untutored genius was creating paradise. So in 1940s, when Art Brut came, when this Dubuffet, you know, he was talking about this concept, then in India at that very time, an untrained artist was making a paradise out of waste. Then this art was had already stepped inside India. Years ago, the little patch of jungle that he began clearing to make himself a garden, sculpted with stone and recycled material, is known to the world today as a rock garden at Chandigarh. So many years ago, when this Art Brut was coming up, then a person called Nek Chand, he cleared a forest area to make for himself a land of art. And that land nowadays is called as Rock Garden in Chandigarh. So if you people have visited Rock Garden, you must all be knowing that this Rock Garden, here these all, you know, creations are out of waste. Its 80-year-old creator, director Nek Chand, is now hailed as India's biggest contributor to outsider art. So the person Nek Chand, who was at that time 80 years old, you know, he is now called as India's biggest contributor to Art Brut. Art Brut means outsider art. The 50th issue of Raw Vision, a UK-based magazine, pioneer in outsider art publications, features Nek Chand and his rock garden sculpture, Women by the Waterfall, on its anniversary issue cover. See the kind of fame this rock garden has. See the kind of, you know, acclaim this Nek Chand has got. So his picture and one of his, you know, creations at Rock Garden, they were there in the main cover of that very magazine. What was its name? Raw Vision. The notion of Art Brut or raw art was of works that were in their raw state as regards cultural and artistic influences. The idea of Art Brut or the raw art, it was of works that were in their raw state as regards cultural and artistic influences. So main thing is that the Art Brut, the outsider art, it had the influence of culture and artistic things upon it. So artistic, or you can say cultural, influences dominated Art Brut. Anything and everything from a tin to a sink to a broken down car would be material for a work of art. So what's the biggest fact about this Art Brut? That anything which is a waste, maybe it's about a tin or a sink or a broken car, anything, even the pieces of bangles, you know, they are all of use in Art Brut. Nowadays we even talk about it as best out of waste. So something Nek Chand has taken to dizzying heights. So it was Nek Chand who took this kind of art to the great heights. Recognizing his art as an outstanding testimony of the difference a single man can make when he lives his dream. So this work, what Nek Chand has done, that is a proof that one single man can do the greatest things ever. So the Swiss Commission for UNESCO will be honoring him by way of European exposition of his works. So even UNESCO, you know, they honored Nek Chand. The 5-month interactive show, Realm of Nek Chand, beginning October, will be held at leading museums in Switzerland. So children, this article was written in 2005. So then this writer is telling us that he would be honored in Switzerland, that he would be honored at leading museums in Switzerland, Belgium, France, and Italy. So in 2005, he might have been honored. The biggest reward is walking through the garden and seeing people enjoy my creation, Nek Chand says. So what's the biggest reward Nek Chand says he has? He says the biggest reward is when I see people walking through the garden and enjoying. So actually, whenever somebody visits Chandigarh, one cannot miss the visit to Rock Garden. And Rock Garden is actually a world in itself, where you can see the examples of best out of waste. Okay, and Nate Chand is the pioneer of that. Right. So with this, you know, we finish off this chapter. So this chapter basically had three kinds of things: Chinese art, European art, and Art Brut. And in this Art Brut, we talked about Nate Chand, the Rock Garden, and all. Right. So with this, our syllabus also has finished. But yes, from the other book, we might do one more chapter next week. That might be the very first chapter, the Summer of Beautiful White Horse. We might do. We'll see that. Right. So otherwise, from this book, your syllabus has finished. We have done rather extra chapters of term two also. But term two will not be in term one, because that was before the syllabus had come. So extra chapters which we have done, that we can compensate for what we have not done yet, because term one is up till November. But your exams in September will be there. And in those exams, these chapters which we have not done yet might not be there. So that I'll tell you next week finally, right? So till then, you people go through the questions of this chapter at the back. So understanding the text, there are three questions, and then talking about the text too. So do these and do all these back exercises. And next week will be the test of this very chapter, children, right? Is that right? Yes, the people who are here: Arshdeep Singh, roll number 7, Aryaman, Divanshi, Garf, Gursira, Japan Chot, Jatin, Kavya and Kavya, Mannat, Navkirat, Udayveer and Vriti. Okay, Vriti, then Yashika, Yuvraj Singh, roll number 44, 46, Himanshu Dheer and Anmol Singh. Okay. Anmol Singh, better write down your roll number along with your name. Okay. It becomes easier to mark attendance. Okay, children, so prepare this chapter thoroughly, okay, for the text next week, and rest we will discuss, okay? Okay, thank you. You can utilize this time which you think it's saved.